Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Paper Cuts by Ellery Adams. Narrated by Cris Dukehart. When people hurt you over and over, think of them like sandpaper. They may scratch and hurt you a bit, but in the end, you end up polished, and they end up useless. Cris Colfer. Paper is more patient than man. Anne Frank. Chapter 1. What is better than wisdom? Woman. And what is better than a good woman? Nothing. Geoffrey Chaucer.
I loved this book.
Hester Winthrop stroked the paperback on her lap as if it were a cat.
I underlined a bunch of passages, but my favorite line was when Alma said, "Always remember that food is medicine, and medicine is food."
The perfect arch of Estella's left brow rose a centimeter. Your food is more like therapy than actual medicine. Hester laughed.
Come on. Does broccoli make you feel better when you're down? No, it doesn't.
Certain times call for donuts and chocolate cake. And pecan pie. With ice cream.
If comfort food isn't medicine, then I don't know what is.
Maybe I should shelve a few baking books in the health section, said Nora Pennington, proprietor of Miracle Books. June Dixon, guest experience manager at Miracle Springs Lodge, a high-class resort frequented by guests from all over the world, peered at her friends from over the rims of her reading glasses.
All I can say is that I'm glad to be living in this era of body positivity. When I was in school, back in the Stone Age, girls were always trash-talking other girls. I don't know why, but we all did it. From the top of our heads right on down to our toes. We were too big, too small, too pointy, too wide. No one wore the right clothes. And don't even get me started on hair. You don't know nasty until you hear what some folks say about black hair.
That kind of thing doesn't stop when girls become women either, said Estella. Every time I put two ladies of any age, race, or class under the blow dryers together, they start picking apart the celebrities and people. I don't know why all women can't just be happy when other women succeed. Why can't we tell another woman they look good without worrying about how we look?
Hester smiled at Estella. You always look good. And June, you're channeling Etta James with that new do.
June passed a hand over her head.
She usually kept it close-cropped, but Estella had convinced her to rock a teeny-weeny icy blonde afro.
Which tea would Etta order?
She asked as she studied the paper menu on the table before her.
Beautiful or feeling flirty?
Nora removed her copy of Lisa C's The Tea Girl of Hummingbird Lane from her bag and placed it on the table. She was ready to order and get their book discussion going.
I'm going to try the flirty, she said.
I've never had tea with hibiscus and apple before.
I've never even heard of flowering tea. I might be in the food business, but I...
Hester was unable to finish her sentence because Estella suddenly grabbed her by the hand and said,
You're not wearing your ring. Did you forget to put it on?
Color rushed to Hester's cheeks and she lowered her eyes.
It didn't feel right to wear it. Things are weird between Jasper and me right now, so I gave it back. The ring belonged to his mother, which is why he should hold on to it.
But you're still together, right?
Yeah, we're just taking a step back. Being engaged put too much pressure on our relationship. It's easier to tell people that we decided to put off the wedding than to explain that we're in couples therapy because I have trust issues. Luckily, no one's asked me why we postponed the wedding. Without that ginormous event hanging over our heads, we can focus on us without feeling like there's a clock ticking down the minutes to a wedding.
Nora searched her friend's face. Are you okay? Hester seesawed her hand.
I'm getting there. This is gonna sound awful, but I feel lighter without that ring on my finger. Our couples counselor asked us to pretend like we've just met, so that's what we're doing. We're going out on dates and getting to know each other all over again. It's strange and super awkward at times, but it's also kind of sweet. Last night, Jasper walked me to my front door and kissed me goodnight. He seemed almost shy.
Maybe you can bring him here for a lunch date. Everything on the menu sounds good, but tastes like royalty was made for me, don't you think? Estella tossed her auburn hair and cupped her chin in her palms. Yes, Fergie, it does. I'm getting a cuppa with my best tea. June put her menu down. Looks like we order at the counter. Is everybody ready? The four women maneuvered around tables and potted trees on their way to the counter. It was their first visit to tea flowers, and there was so much to take in. The newest business in Miracle Springs was an eclectic blend of cafe and garden shop. The large space was divided into sections, with the tea shop on the left and the garden shop on the right. A checkout counter sat in the middle. The limited menu offered flowering teas, sandwiches, and a selection of macarons. After ordering at the counter, customers could sit at one of the tables in the dining area. The tables were laid with chintz cloths, featuring pink roses on a field of pale blue. The floral centerpieces, which were in teapot-shaped vases, were all for sale, and the salt and pepper shakers looked like real blossoms. The tea shop side of the business was confined to the counter and dining area, but most of the building was dedicated to gardening. The front section was full of waist-high tables featuring potted herbs, houseplants, flowering plants, and hanging baskets. The shelf space in the back half of the store was stuffed with whimsical pots, gardening tools, birdhouses, and feeders, and a selection of small statuary. Spinning racks stood like sentinels at the end of every aisle, their pockets stuffed with seed packets, work gloves, and plant labels. All the potted trees and plants in the cafe side were for sale. And as Nora and her friends got in line, they heard the customers ahead of them debating over whether to buy the plant on their table, a maidenhair fern in a Ruth Bader Ginsburg face pot, or the snake plant in the llama pot from a neighboring table.
"Can we really pick a llama over RBG?"
one man said to the other.
"We can't. Let's get both. RBG for us, and the llama for your boss. Remember the Christmas party? She was spitting mad when I stole that white elephant gift."
The first man put his credit card on the counter and gave his partner an affectionate nudge.
"She still talks about that. I'm gonna give her the llama, so I can think about you every time I'm in her office." "You should come here more often. Tea makes you extra sweet."
According to her name tag, the middle-aged brunette behind the counter was Val. She was short and apple-cheeked, with blue-gray eyes and a quiet manner. After telling Nora and her friends that she'd be with them in a moment, Val began packing the men's plants in a small box. Nora handed June some money. "Will you order for me? I want to check out that Language of Flowers display." Scooting behind the two men, Nora examined the baskets of blooming flowers on a tiered display stand. Each basket came with a detailed label and a satin bow. The sympathy basket was made of marigold for grief, mint for consolation, and chrysanthemum for condolences. The Friends Forever basket had crocus for cheerfulness, ivy for loyalty, and zinnia for friendship. Other baskets were called Love Me Tender, Happy Home, and Let's Celebrate. But Nora was most intrigued by the I Will Survive basket. Leaning closer, she read the label to herself. Carnation for heartache. Yarrow, to cure a broken heart. Rue for regret, and Lily of the Valley for happiness in the future.
"Interesting?"
June asked when Nora rejoined the group. "Very. I never think about what flowers mean when I buy them at the grocery store. I just grab the colors I like and plop a bouquet in my cart. Who knows?
All this time, I might have been buying flowers for the shop that mean, I hope you drop dead, instead of please spend lots of money here today. June laughed.
I want a bouquet that says stop leaving your dirty dishes in the break room sink when the dishwasher's a foot away.
Having finished ringing in their tea and sandwich orders, Val gave Estella a number flag to put on their table. While they waited for their food, Nora told her other friends about the basket of flowers. Like June, Hester was interested, but Estella was lost in her own thoughts. She stared at the number in the center of their table and didn't say a word. What's wrong? Nora asked. By way of reply, Estella opened her copy of The Tea Girl of Hummingbird Lane to a passage marked with a pink sticky tab. Want to hear my favorite quote? It feels like it was written for us.
Go on,
Hester prompted. One mistake can change the course of your life. You can never return to your original path or go back to the person you were. The women exchanged meaningful looks. They'd all made mistakes. Big ones. The kind of mistakes that turned family into strangers and made homes uninhabitable. Each woman had done something they deeply regretted. Their mistakes had left deep scars. And though the pain had lessened with time, it would never fully disappear. They couldn't think about the past without being pricked by cactus spines of regret. Nora would forever feel shame over what she'd done. She'd gotten behind the wheel after drinking way too much and had crashed into another car. The victims of her reckless behavior had been a mother and child. Their car caught fire, and Nora had been burned pulling the woman and her toddler to safety. They sustained minor injuries, but Nora sustained burns from her right hand to her hairline. She lost half a pinky finger and gained lots of shiny, shell-smooth scars. A few years ago, a plastic surgeon had worked wonders on her face. Unless one looked closely, her scars were nearly invisible. The surgeon had offered to repair all the evidence of Nora's burns, but she'd refused. The damaged skin on her neck, arm, and hand served as a constant reminder that she nearly killed two innocent people. Before June began working at the hotel, she cared for seniors at an assisted living facility in New York. During her 15-year tenure, she'd treated each and every resident with compassion and respect. But when the facility was acquired by a national chain, things changed. The grade school kids who came once a week to play board games with the residents were no longer allowed to visit. There was no more animal therapy. The beautiful gardens were neglected, and outings became more and more infrequent. Seeing how depressed the residents had become, June sought to cheer them up by bringing them to a carnival. Unfortunately, a gentleman in her care suffered a fatal heart attack that day. When his family sued June for damages, she lost her life savings and the money she and her husband had saved for their son's college tuition. In the aftermath, her husband filed for divorce, and she and her son became estranged. Hester, the youngest of the four women, had faced an unexpected pregnancy as a high schooler. After degrading her and imprisoning her in her room, Hester's parents sent her to a home for unwed mothers. The moment the baby was born, Hester's daughter was whisked away into the waiting arms of her new parents. Hester never had the chance to hold her. Traumatized by the experience, she never told the baby's father about the pregnancy or searched for her daughter. 20 years later, her daughter tracked her down. What could have been a joyful occasion was marred by violence and grief. And now, weekly letters were Hester's only communication with her child. Estella was the only Miracle Springs native of the Secret Book and Scone Society. Hers had been a hard scrabble childhood. Raised by a negligent mother, Estella had not only been physically and emotionally abused by her mother's boyfriends, but she'd also experienced the hunger and humiliation of poverty. And when her biological father, a man who'd been absent for most of Estella's childhood, returned home to find the new man in the house assaulting his daughter, he drew a gun and killed the man on the spot.
Estella had always dreamed of escaping Miracle Springs. But with her father imprisoned nearby, she couldn't leave. She felt responsible for his incarceration, and that guilt had manifested in a series of flings with strangers. The dalliances, which left Estella feeling hollow and tarnished a reputation, ended when she fell in love with a local man named Jack Nakamura. Right now, Estella didn't look like a woman in love. Nora saw tension in the fine lines around her mouth and brows. "I liked that quote too," Nora said. "It reminded me of why we became the secret book in Scone Society. We've always trusted each other with our secrets. We tell each other things we'd never tell anyone else. So, what's going on? Whatever it is, we've got you." Estella touched the number card. 15. That's how many years my daddy's been in prison. He's being released next week.
"That's a good thing, right?"
Hester asked. "Yes, of course it is." Estella unfolded her napkin and spread it over her lap. She smoothed the white cloth over and over. "He and I have talked about this 100 times. You know, which foods he'd want and how he couldn't wait to go to a barber shop, take a walk around town, or have the bathroom all to himself. But we've never talked about the nuts and bolts. What's he gonna do for money? How is he going to adjust? This is a very different world from the one he used to live in." June murmured in agreement. "Listen, honey, I know a bit of what you're going through. Tyson was in rehab for a long time, and you remember what it was like when he got out. He had to spend months in the halfway house before he was ready to live and work on his own. He's come a long way, but he's still uncomfortable around strangers. He still looks over his shoulder, half expecting to see the dealers he stole from when he was using. My boy is in his 30s, but he lost years to those damn drugs. In some ways, he's still a kid. In others, he's an old man. Time didn't stand still for your father, but it didn't move as fast as it did for you. The pace is gonna be hard for him to handle at first." People weren't glued to their cell phones 15 years ago. They didn't drive electric cars or fly to space just for kicks, said Nora. "He doesn't need to adjust to any of that, but I imagine it'll be a shock to see how different the town is now. And the people he knew before he went inside, they're gonna look different too." Estella said, "I've brought him the local paper for years, so he's not totally in the dark about our area. He's gonna live with me until he finds his feet. I don't know what he'll do for work, but all the articles I've read say that a job is super important. It's the one thing all former prisoners need to feel like they're back in society. They need the routine and the responsibility. Earning money is important. Working gives them a sense of pride. It'll keep Daddy from getting depressed." "Has he had any vocational training?" asked June. "Just food service. He cooked for the inmates whenever he had the chance. He even developed special menus, Super Bowl meals and things like that. I bought him a few cookbooks so he could have some fun in my kitchen. I figured it would be good for him to putter around at home for a few days and get used to his freedom before he goes looking for a job." Nora cocked her head.
"Would Jack hire him to work in the diner?"
"I don't think that's a good idea," Estella said. "He'll find something. But in the meantime, I'd like to read some books talk about reentering society after prison. I've a week to do whatever I can to help him transition." June smiled at Estella. "You're a good woman. Don't tell anyone. I have my bad girl reputation to protect." Their conversation was curtailed when Val appeared with their orders. She distributed 4 small glass teapots and 4 plates of sandwiches. Finally, she put a plate of flower-shaped macarons on the center of the table.
"These are on the house," she said with a smile. "And since this is your first time, let me tell you how your flowering tea works. Each teapot has a bulb made of tea leaves and flowers. In a few seconds, the bulbs will expand and slowly unfurl. Once it blooms,
You'll see the flowers inside. Let your tea steep for a few minutes before you drink it. Hester said, Do you mind if I take a video? Not at all. Enjoy.
Val started to turn away when her gaze caught on Nora's right arm. Strangers were always fascinated by the burn scars that floated like jellyfish over the back of Nora's hand and up the length of her arm. Most adults gave her a good once-over before eventually turning away in embarrassment. Children had no such compunction and would often ask why her skin was bubbly or why she was missing the top half of her finger. She always told them she'd been in an accident, but her scars no longer hurt. Though Nora felt the weight of Val's stare, she was too enraptured by her flowering tea to worry about it. The bulb of tea leaves slowly unfurled, and a centerpiece of dried flowers floated in her glass teapot. That's the coolest thing I've ever seen, she said to Val. Finally tearing her eyes away from Nora, Val saw customers waiting at the counter and hurried off. Nora and her friends resumed their discussion of the tea girl of Hummingbird Lane, bouncing back and forth between scenes from the book and anecdotes from their own lives. They also talked about the upcoming Honey Bee Jubilee.
For the next 2 weeks, my bakery will be stuffed to the gills with honey-flavored treats and flower-shaped cookies.
Hester plucked a daisy macaron off the plate and examined it with a critical eye.
This is beautiful work. I'm glad it's the only dessert item on their menu. You know I like being the only baked goods game in town.
June bit into a sunflower macaron. Oh, yum. Mine's lemon and strawberry. Estella took a nibble out of her tulip-shaped cookie and grimaced. Ick. Coconut.
The rose is red velvet, said Nora.
You picked the winner, June. Hester chewed her cookie thoughtfully.
They're pretty, but I think they were baked somewhere else and shipped frozen.
I'm gonna bring some back for Sheldon, Nora said. That man needs a treat because even though he pretends he's not, he's still tired from yesterday's story time. He read Where the Wild Things Are and made monster crowns with the kids. The whole children's section was covered in glitter and feathers, including Sheldon. His mustache was twinkling like a disco ball. While her friends cackled with glee, Nora headed to the counter to order a sampler box of macarons. Val was taking a phone order and didn't see Nora, so she ambled over to a display of low-maintenance houseplants. She was immediately drawn to a Chinese money plant in a hedgehog pot. The hedgehog wore glasses and was too cute to ignore.
That plant'll bring you luck,
said a man holding a pricing gun. I could always use more of that. The man moved closer. His name tag, which read Kirk, was pinned to the front pocket of his khaki work shirt. Of average height, he had a thick torso and hands as wide and square as slices of bread. His brown hair was graying at the temples. His brows were bushy, and he had the weather-beaten skin of an outdoorsman.
The luck is specific to money, Kirk said. See how the leaves look like coins?
I could really use that kind of luck. I'm trying to save up for a car. She sighed. I'd like to put this on the checkout counter in my bookshop, but I have a brown thumb.
Kirk's brows twitched. The bookstore on the corner. That's you?
At Nora's nod, he gave her the same overt assessment Val had given her. The only difference was he was quicker to break eye contact. Gesturing at the plant, he said,
Here's all you need to know to care for it. Don't overwater. Let the soil dry out between waterings. You'll know when it needs a drink because the leaves will look droopy. It doesn't like direct sunlight, but if it gets indirect light and you rotate it once in a while, you won't kill it. If you need a plant medic, you know where to find me.
The man I work with keeps saying that we need a store mascot. What could beat a ceramic hedgehog with glasses? As Nora carried the potted plant to the checkout counter, she felt the tickle of Kirk's stare on her back. Val rang her up, packed the macarons, and lowered the plant into a box, shooting glances at Nora's face the whole time. Nora had had enough of the woman's ogling.
"Here's the deal," she said. 10 years ago, I was in a fire. That's why my right arm looks the way it does. My face used to be much worse, but I had surgery. I only have half a pinky, but that didn't stop me from eating that curried egg salad sandwich in record time. Do you make all of the food here?"
Pink splotches appeared on Val's cheeks.
"Not the macarons. We order those from a bakery in Brooklyn. I do the tea and the sandwiches. Kirk, that's my husband, takes care of the plant side of things. We're new to town."
Val was talking a mile a minute, and her movements were jerky. Nora couldn't understand why she was so flustered.
"Get over it, lady. I have a few scars. I'm not the Phantom of the Opera."
Kirk appeared from the back room and began looking through some papers on the desk, directly behind his wife.
When he didn't find what he wanted, he touched Val's shoulder.
She startled so violently that she swept the box with the potted plant right off the counter. It crashed to the floor in front of Nora, flinging soil and bits of broken pottery everywhere.
"Oh, I'm so sorry," she cried.
Kirk pivoted his wife around until she faced the back room.
"I'll clean it up. There's another hedgehog pot on the third shelf in the storeroom. Get it, and I'll fix the plant right up."
Clinging to his arm, Val whispered, "I'm sorry, I got nervous when I saw her."
"Go on, Val. I'll sweep up."
Nora was tempted to take her macarons and leave, but she'd already paid for the potted plant and didn't want to wait around for Val to refund her money. She didn't want to interact with Val at all. The woman was clearly fascinated and repulsed by Nora. Nora wasn't interested in being studied like a specimen under glass. Kirk came around the counter with a broom and dustpan.
"The good news is the plant's fine. Give me just a minute while I add a little soil to a new pot."
Leaving him to clean up the mess and repot the plant, Nora returned to her friends.
"Are you causing trouble?"
Estella teased. Nora pulled a face.
"Do I have lettuce in my teeth or something? I'm used to people giving me the once over, but that woman is making me feel like a circus attraction."
"You think everyone's grossed out by your scars, but she's probably staring at you because you're beautiful," said June. "People do it all the time. You still see yourself as the woman with a scarred face, but no one else does. You need to say goodbye to her, once and for all."
Though Nora knew Val hadn't been admiring her, she let the subject drop. Since it was a Monday and Hester was the only one who didn't need to get back to work, Nora told them to go ahead without her. June slipped her crossbody bag over her head and wiggled a finger at Nora.
"Tell Sheldon not to eat those macarons right before dinner. I'm making one of his favorites tonight, lemon chicken and butter beans. That man hit the jackpot when he became my housemate."
"I'm having a big salad. All these dinner meals are catching up to me," said Estella.
Hester eyed Estella's trim waist.
"You never gain weight."
"That's the power of an A-line dress," Estella said, glancing at her watch. "I need to run, the mayor's coming in at 4. She's decided to go silver, and it's gonna look amazing. She's ditching her French manicure, too. She wants fuchsia on her hands and navy on her toes. Oh, how I love helping a woman transform."
Estella bustled out of the shop to several admiring glances.
"She's a force of nature. I wish I was like that,"
Hester said with a sigh in her voice. June waved her comment aside.
"You have your own gifts. We all do. Estella can't conjure memories with her baked goods. I can't give people the perfect book recommendation. And none of you can knit worth a damn."
Hester laughed.
"That's true. Maybe I don't want to be a force of nature either. Maybe I want a transformation like the mayor's getting."
"You want to go silver?" Nora joked.
Hester twirled a strand of honey-colored hair around her finger.
"I want to get out of bed and not have to deal with these curls. I've worn my hair in a headband or ponytail since I was in high school. But when your workday starts at 5 a.m., being stylish is the last thing on your mind."
June ran a hand over her head.
"You could shave it all off. It is incredibly liberating."
That's a bit too liberating. How about a shag?
Is that a haircut or a proposal? Hester and June headed for the exit, laughing as they walked. Nora returned to the counter where Kirk had her potted plant ready to go.
Hope to see you again soon,
he said, pushing the box across the counter. His smile was perfunctory. He suddenly seemed eager for her to leave. Nora bristled. Because she'd had her share of rude, impatient, and self-centered customers, she went out of her way to be polite to those in the service industry. If this is how Val and Kirk were going to react to her burn scars, how would they treat other customers with obvious physical differences? Knowing she had no chance of getting through to them by being hostile, she took a deep breath and spoke in a casual but direct manner. I'd like to come back here again, but I'm not sure if I will. Your wife is clearly uncomfortable around me. I'm used to people staring at my scars, but they usually get over it after a few minutes. Kirk flapped his hands like a pair of agitated birds.
Oh, no. She's just not herself right now. You see, we never planned on moving here. We came to be close to my sister and to help out with her son.
His eyes clouded with sorrow.
My sister, she's sick. She's tried everything, including the hot springs, but now she's just trying to manage her pain and live what little time she has in peace.
When Kirk turned away to compose himself, Nora said, I'm sorry. That must be really hard. Hundreds of years ago, the Cherokee traveled to the hot springs to experience the healing properties of mineral waters. Over time, the waters had attracted more and more people. As hotels, shops, and eateries were built to cater to these visitors, Miracle Springs became known as a retreat for those grappling with physical or emotional illness. The hot springs weren't magical. The waters couldn't cure cancer, undo trauma, or fix a broken heart. They could offer rest and hope. And if these failed, the beautiful scenery, kind residents, and charming shops and eateries provided escapism and comfort. Most visitors found their way to Miracle Books, lured in by colorful window displays and the promise of a good read. Over the years, Nora had heard some sad stories. She knew how people could act when they were scared. And if Kirk's sister was gravely ill, it was no wonder he and Val were on edge. Nora picked up her box and said, This is a good place to find peace. I hope that's what your sister finds. Another customer was approaching the counter. Kirk darted a glance his way as he murmured something in response. Though it made no sense, Nora could have sworn he said,
That depends on you.
Chapter 2. She would disappear, folded into origami, like her own dreams. Lauren Bucus. Nora used the delivery door to enter Miracle Books. She dropped her handbag in the stockroom and wheeled a hand truck stacked with new releases up the hall. As she passed the restroom, she was greeted by familiar sounds. The blend of instrumental jazz, murmured voices, gurgling espresso machine and rustling pages was the music of the bookstore. Sheldon Vega, Nora's friend and only employee, called out,
I have a Jack London for Daphne and a Louisa May Alcott for Zara. Heather, your Dante Alighieri is on deck.
For the next 20 seconds, the loud hiss of the milk frother obliterated all other sounds. Nora parked the hand truck in the nook between science fiction and fantasy and headed into the ticket agent's booth. Though it was now a kitchen and coffee station, the space had once been dedicated to the sale of train tickets. The building that housed Miracle Books was the town's original train station. When the modern station was built a mile down the line, the old one was put up for sale. It languished on the market for a long time, becoming more and more decrepit, until a patient in a burn unit saw the listing and decided to buy it.
It had taken every penny of Nora's savings to cover the down payment on the building and the stretch of land behind the store. She also bought a retired caboose, converted it into a tiny house, and parked it on the hill, overlooking the train tracks. Every night she heard the whistles of nighttime freight trains. The sweet, haunting sound evoked a desire for adventure, or a sudden longing. Passengers no longer rushed through the former station, because Miracle Books was a place of slow movements and lowered voices. Upon entering the bookstore, people wandered through the rabbit warren of shelves, browsed the titles on the display tables, and spent hours in the reading chairs. They'd open books, scan blurbs, and sniff pages. They'd put away their phones and read. They'd meet friends for coffee or sit on the alphabet rug with their kids to read picture books. For an hour or so, they'd find peace in the oasis of colorful book spines. Though Nora knew Miracle Books was a haven of quiet and calm in a chaotic world, she hadn't expected to see so many people in the store. A large after-lunch crowd was unusual, but a crowd of young adults occupied the area around the ticket agent's booth as well as the reader's circle. Where'd this group come from? She whispered to Sheldon as he cleaned the milk frother wand.
They are on a 5-day brewery tour of Western North Carolina. They started in Charlotte and continued to Asheville from there. After Miracle Springs, they'll head to Boone. See those two cuties by the Everything's Coming Up romance end cap? They just got married. And instead of having a wedding reception, they rounded up the people they loved most and did this trip. Isn't that cool? So much more fun than a dinner of rubber chicken and dancing to Sister Sledge on a parquet dance floor.
Pointing at the coffee mug in Sheldon's hand, Nora said, Are you sobering them up before they get back on the road?
You know what they say about assumptions.
Sheldon scolded.
These fine folks don't drink during the day. They hike, sample local cuisine, visit art galleries or shops. One of the reasons they came to Miracle Springs was to hike part of the Appalachian Trail. The other reason was to visit our store. They've already put aside a stack of books to buy. I am telling you, these are our people.
I'll go say hello in a sec, but I wanted to give you your treat first. They're macarons from Tea Flowers. Nora opened the box to show Sheldon the flower-shaped cookies.
Oh, pretty. How was the tea?
Also pretty. The owners seem out of their depth. They moved here with a sick family member and are running the business and helping out with a family member and her kid. I was relaxed when I got there. By the time I left, not so much. But I did buy a magical plant that will make us rich. Sheldon smoothed the silver tails of his glorious mustache with one hand while shooing her away with the other.
I want all the details, especially the rich part, but not now. Right now, I have lattes to make and cookies to eat.
Nora glanced at the tower of dirty mugs in the sink. As soon as I put the new releases out, I'll be back to wash those mugs. After greeting the 20-somethings, all of whom were contentedly amassing small piles of books while they socialized, Nora replenished missing titles from the new fiction table and then wheeled the empty hand truck to the stockroom. She returned to the front to find a customer waiting for her at the checkout counter. The woman's attention was focused on the boy spinning the bookmark tower around and around. Nora could tell just by looking at her that the woman wasn't well. Because she ran a business in a town known for its healing waters, Nora's customers had a wide range of medical conditions. Some were obvious, others were less visible. The woman at the counter looked extremely fragile. Her skin was stretched tight over her bones and was so pale that it was almost colorless. She wore a chemo cap covered in tiny Princess Leia figures. The royal purple hue emphasized both her pallor and the brilliance of her blue-green eyes. Her brows were pencil lines drawn by an unsteady hand, and her lips were chapped. She watched the boy so intently that she was unaware of Nora's presence. A donkey bray of a laugh echoed from deeper in the store, and the woman turned. Smiling at Nora, she said, "He'll do that all day if I let him. He likes how the glittery ones sparkle in the sunlight." Unlike the children who spun the rack around fast enough to dislodge a handful of bookmarks, the woman's son was being very careful. "They're my favorite too, especially the peacock." The woman seemed relieved that Nora wasn't going to ask her son to leave the bookmarks alone. "I came to find something for him, for Tucker. He's gotten really into origami lately, and he's really good at it. Do you carry any origami books?" "Let me check." As Nora opened her laptop, she pictured the puzzles and game section. The shelves held such a hodgepodge of activity books that she wasn't sure exactly what she had in stock. "It looks like we have one kit and two books. One of the books is called Easy Origami. It has over 30 projects, but doesn't come with any paper. The kit comes with an instruction booklet of 75 patterns and 100 sheets of paper. The projects range from easy to challenging. We also have The Strange Case of Origami Yoda. It's a middle grade fiction book about a sixth grade boy who makes origami." The woman's eyes lit up. "Tucker's in fifth grade. I bet he'd love that book. Can you show me that one and the kit with the different levels? He's done a bunch of beginner patterns already." "Sure. Come on back." The woman walked over to the bookmark spinner and, without touching her son or the spinner, held out her hand like a traffic cop. "Tucker, please stop. We're going to a different part of the store to look for your books. Do you want to stay here or come with us?" Tucker continued to turn the spinner. His mother repeated her question and then told Tucker that she was going to walk away at the count of three. She finished the count and approached Nora. A second later, Tucker released the spinner and turned to follow her. He took one step before directing a lightning-quick glance at Nora. Then he fixed his gaze on the ground. As they rounded the fiction section and passed by the group occupying the chairs in the reader's circle, Tucker hunched his shoulders and lowered his head like a turtle pulling into its shell. He only relaxed when Nora took the origami kit off the shelf and held it out to him. "What do you think, Tuck?" his mother said. The boy's face glowed with excitement.
"I like it. It has the cat and the butterfly and the blinking eye. I can make a bunch of Pokemon and a panda and a box with a lid."
His speech was a rapid-fire mumble that Nora found difficult to follow. It was as if his mouth couldn't keep up with the avalanche of words tumbling through his brain.
"Hold on to that while we see what else this nice lady has to show us," his mother said.
On the way to the children's corner, Nora introduced herself.
"I've met you before, actually," the woman said. "I'm Kelly. Tucker and I just moved here, but I was in your shop the first time I came to this town."
"I'm happy to have a repeat customer as a new neighbor," Nora said. When they reached the children's corner, Tucker walked over to the letter T on the alphabet rug and sat down to read the fine print on the back of the origami kit. The Strange Case of Origami Yoda was sandwiched between Lloyd Alexander's The Chronicles of Prydain and Darth Paper Strikes Back. When Nora handed the book to Kelly, her eyes sparkled with delight.
"I've heard about this series. The author's neurodivergent. I read somewhere that he calls his aspy behavior his superpower."
She gazed at her son.
"Tuck has superpowers too. I just hope people will be able to see them, like I do."
Sorrow stole the light from Kelly's eyes. In that instant, she looked as small and fragile as a hummingbird egg. Nora recognized the expression on Kelly's face. It was grief. And it was so all-encompassing that it took every ounce of her strength to keep from surrendering to it. In that moment, Nora realized that Kelly didn't expect to live long enough to see her son become a man. She'd probably moved to Miracle Springs in hopes of gaining a little extra time. She'd bathe in the mineral waters, she'd get healing massages and acupuncture. She'd meditate and drink superfood smoothies. She'd do anything in her power to remain here, in this world, with her boy. Nora wished she could wave a magic wand and change Kelly's fate, but all she could offer were books and kindness. Touching Kelly lightly on the shoulder, she said, "I bet his superpowers come from you. It's like the Force in Star Wars. It gets passed down." Kelly grinned.
"Did you hear that, Tucker? I'm like Princess Leia, without all the hair."
She bought both Tom Engelberger books as well as the origami kit. She also asked Nora to order The Secret of the Fortune Wookie. After bagging the books, Nora came around the counter and offered the bag to Tucker. "I'd love to see your origami. If you want to show me any of your projects, you can bring them in. Your mom could have an iced coffee, and you could have a not-so-hot hot chocolate with lots of rainbow marshmallows." Though Tucker didn't make eye contact, he said, "Okay." Kelly flashed Nora a grateful smile and opened the front door, causing the sleigh bells hanging from a hook on the back to jangle noisily. Tucker covered his ears and hurried outside. Materializing at Nora's side, Sheldon pointed at the door.
"See that? You're torturing children with hearing sensitivities with that jingle-jangling beast. A caring, thoughtful person would throw them in the trash and install a motion-automated chime instead."
"For the millionth time, the sleigh bells aren't going anywhere. I don't want more automation in my life." She gave Sheldon a playful poke. "Unless someone invented a robotic barista. If that's a thing, here's my credit card." Sheldon pretended to pull a knife out of his chest.
"Come on, Brutus. I'm gonna have a snack while you wash dishes and tell me about the tea shop."
After making sure the brewery tour folks were still happily sipping coffee and chatting, Nora started washing mugs. Sheldon followed her into the ticket agent's booth and popped a piece of bread into the toaster. Not only was Sheldon the best barista within 100 miles, but he also baked his own Cuban bread. He'd inherited his love of food and music from his Cuban father and his love of reading and fussing over people from his Jewish mother. Sheldon was a gregarious, kind-hearted man with waves of silver hair and a glorious mustache of the same hue, a Santa Claus belly and a loud laugh. His favorite snack was Nutella on toast, and it had become so popular with the customers that Nora added it to the menu, calling it the Shel Silverstein. While he waited on the toaster, he wiped the display case where the book pockets were kept. These lighter-than-air pastries were shaped like books and had either a chocolate or raspberry filling. Hester made the pastries every morning, and Sheldon picked them up on his way to work.
"We are running out of book pockets early and earlier these days. Maybe we should increase our order by 6 and see how it goes."
Hester mentioned that at lunch today. She also thinks we should add a new food item to our menu, the James and the Giant Peach Muffin. Sheldon barked out a laugh.
"Well, I like it. She'll have to go easy on the streusel topping or we'll have crumbs everywhere. I don't mind vacuuming, but I've read if you give a mouse a cookie, and I don't want an army of mice running over my shoes during story time."
"But what if you give a moose a muffin?"
"No mice, moose, meese, or mooses. The only wild animals allowed in this shop are the children. How's Hester?"
Nora turned the water off. She gave her engagement ring back to Jasper. The toaster popped, but Sheldon didn't move.
"Pobrecita."
"It might not be a bad thing. They're trying to start over without the added pressure of a wedding."
"Taking a step back is okay if it's a two-step forward, one-step back situation. I hope they work it all out."
Sheldon opened the Nutella jar and spooned a generous glob onto his toast. When Nora told him that Estella's father was finally being released from prison, he went very still. Nora saw a range of emotions flit across his face. "Hey, are you okay?" After another moment of silence, Sheldon said,
"When I was a kid, my papa's brother lived up the street. My cousin, Alvaro, was older than me and was the coolest cat around. He'd cruise through the neighborhood in this big white Lincoln convertible with red leather seats, always with a beautiful woman, always blaring music. He wore leather jackets in Miami and slicked his hair back like a greaser from The Outsiders. He was our Cubana Matt Dillon.
No wonder you idolized him. Looking wistful, Sheldon went on.
Alvador was a smart kid. He got a full ride to college, but he didn't go. All he cared about was cars, fixing them, driving them, stealing them. He'd get caught, go to jail, get out, and start the cycle all over again. But the last time, there was a kid sleeping in the back seat of the car he stole, and Alvaro never noticed.
Oh, no.
By the time he got out from that stint, he wasn't the Alvaro I knew. He used to be a fun-loving kid. He had style and swagger. But prison turned him into something else. Something lean and mean and damaged. He couldn't handle life on the outside, but he couldn't handle going back either. So one day, he tied a cinder block to his ankle and jumped off a bridge.
Nora waited for Sheldon to go on, but his gaze was distant. He was lost in the past. Then he blinked and, pinching his toast between his thumb and forefinger, dropped it on a plate.
There's a big difference between Alvaro and, I don't know Estella's father's name.
Gus.
The difference between Alvaro and Gus is that Alvaro's family never forgave him. They didn't visit him in prison. They didn't write. He was dead to them. Estella has been there for Gus. She visits, she writes, she makes sure he has enough money. She's a good egg.
Nora gave Sheldon a fond pat on the back. So are you. We should eat and get out of here before the after-school crowd shows up.
I'm not going anywhere until we duke it out over the window display. I want Jack and the Beanstalk. You want Alice in Wonderland. Should we flip a coin or let our customers vote?
I thought this was a dictatorship, Nora grumbled. Sheldon grabbed a coffee stirrer and waved it like a flag.
Viva la revolution!
As soon as Sheldon finished his snack, he affixed a sign to the comment box asking for customers to weigh in on the next theme.
Let the battle begin,
he said on his way out the door. For the rest of the afternoon, Nora was too busy making espresso drinks and selling books to notice who had voted for what. In truth, she'd be fine with either theme. What she most wanted was a glitter-free window display. Glitter stuck to everything, and no amount of vacuuming got rid of it completely. But if Sheldon had his way, every display would include glitter, tinsel, and disco balls. If Sheldon wanted Jack and the Beanstalk, it was because he had visions of bejeweled silver harps and glittery golden goose eggs. Nora wanted an Alice in Wonderland window with less glitter and more nonfiction titles. They could feature books on vegetable gardening, insects, croquet and card games, cake baking, and hosting tea parties. My theme might help the town's new business, too. The Mad Hatter could hold a little sign telling people to find their next adventure at Tea Flowers. As Nora locked up that evening, she was already conjuring images of oversized mushrooms and books blooming in the center of tissue paper roses. She and Sheldon were proud of their current Read the Rainbow display, which featured a book rainbow in a silver pot filled with yellow books. The books had been written by BIPOC authors of every genre, and Nora had printed a shopping list of all the titles to make it easier for her customers to shop for the books in the window. With April coming to an end, Miracle Springs had shrugged off all vestiges of wintertime. The hillsides were a lush green, and trees were flowering and pollen dusted every surface. A few more rains would wash away the rest of the yellow-green sneezing powder, and the residents of Miracle Springs would spend the month of May working on their gardens. Between the Honeybee Jubilee and the annual garden tour, locals would spend less time reading and more time outdoors. And since Nora was saving up to buy a car, she wanted every customer to leave her shop carrying a bag full of books. She was thinking about her car budget as she walked along the edge of the parking lot behind the bookshop, when an SUV with a sheriff's department seal pulled into a spot right in front of her, she stopped and waited for the driver to hop out. "Parking in the loading zone, eh?" Nora said as she moved toward the man in uniform. "I'll have to report you to your superior officer." Sheriff Grant McCabe hooked his thumbs through his utility belt.
I only answer to one person in this town. Maybe you know her. She sells books. She's beautiful and smart. She can be a little bossy, but she has great taste in men.
Laughing, Nora gave McCabe a hello kiss. I didn't expect to see you until later.
I know it's my turn to make dinner, but my afternoon meeting ran way late, so...
We're eating out. Nora guessed. McCabe nodded.
We haven't been to Pearl's in a while. Do you feel like soul food?
Always. You can tell me about your day while I get changed. Grabbing her hand, McCabe raised his brows in suggestion.
How hungry are you?
Nora studied the man she'd been friends with for years but had only begun to date a few months ago. McCabe was in his mid-50s and bore a slight resemblance to Sam Elliott. Though he didn't sport a mustache, McCabe had a perpetual 5 o'clock shadow. His salt-and-pepper hair was close-trimmed. He carried a little extra weight around his middle, and he had a low, rumbling laugh. Nora loved his dedication to his community, his sharp mind, and the way he listened with his whole being. Most of all, she liked sitting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.